Good morning, everybody. If you want to take a seat, we will get started. A hush falls over the crowd. All right, there are yellow communication cards, as you know, in the seat pew in front of you. So I hope you'll grab one of those if you have prayer requests, or if you're a visitor, we very much want to know that you are here visiting with us today. And we'd love it if you'd fill out one of those cards and just leave it on the pew beside you when you get up to go. If you're visiting for the very first time, we have a gift for you, and you can claim that if you go to the Welcome Center, which is just out through these doors. Be sure to do that before you leave the building today. Growth groups are going to be starting up again, and we have two options for you. If you prefer Zoom over live, you have that option depending on which group you want to attend. So if you need more details about that, or if you'd like to enroll, please talk to Pastor John, who's up here right now in the front row. There's a brief meeting for parents of Sunday school aged children immediately following the service this morning. So if you've got Sunday school aged kids, please come right up here to the front of the sanctuary for that meeting. I'm sure it will be very brief. That would be preschool and elementary children. A lot of great things happening at the church this week, so put on your thinking cap and commit these to memory. Wednesday evening at 5:30, the youth Bible study is going to start up again for the fall in the youth room upstairs. Also, Awana is starting up again. And this week, the registration is on Wednesday the 9th, and then the regular club meetings will begin on September 16th at 6:20 p.m. Now, if you have kids that you have concerns about and you would rather that they participated from home rather than coming into the church, there are listeners available by phone. So contact Debbie Buxton about that if you need some more information. Now, today is still time to register for men's camp. Men's camp is coming up this next weekend, but it's not too late. So pull out your checkbook, $45 for adults. There is information and registration brochures in the information booth in the lobby. So that's up where the Welcome Center is. I'm sorry, next to the Welcome Center. And if you've got questions, Pastor Brett can answer those for you. Now, I told you there was lots of things happening this week. The Women's Roots and Rocks Hiking Group will be heading to Upper Dry Creek in Boise on Saturday morning. So check your bulletin for more information about that and get your sneakers on. There are four new adult Sunday school classes that are starting in 2 weeks on Sunday, September 20th. The classes and their locations are in the bulletin, so don't throw your bulletin away. There's a lot of information in there you're going to want to refer to. And as always, there is an offering box on the table in front of the library doors back here in the foyer if you would like to make a contribution. Check your bulletins. There's a lot more stuff that we don't have time to cover. You don't want to miss anything good.
Good morning. Yeah, I want to just add my welcome to everyone here. It is always good to gather together, and I look forward next week to being up at the retreat with some men and spending some time up there, and that should be a great time. The Sunday school class is starting in 2 weeks. We've had one adult class. We're going to move to having four classes that will include adults and families throughout the church, still providing social distancing opportunities, but giving you a choice between four different studies. And so those are listed in there. Next week we'll have more detailed information to share with you. We want to just continue to come back to the worship, come back to Sunday school, and move in that direction. So for now, I would ask you to all stand with me, and let's repeat our new verse of the month. With me, Psalm 19, 1 and 2. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours out speech, and night to night reveals knowledge. You may, one and two. Thank you. You may be seated. Father, I want to come to you this morning. I just want to lift up our hearts to you, Lord. We thank you that we can come here and be here to worship you with a song and with our prayers and with our hearts listening to your word. I pray, Lord, that you would remind us that we are your children, and no matter what's taken place, you are have that unconditional love for us, that we can always come back to you. So whatever our needs this morning, Father, we know that we can come to you, and you're the one who wants to care for us and care for our needs. This morning, Lord, allow us to hear your voice. We ask the Spirit to pull the blinders from our eyes to see clearly how you are speaking to us through your word. But this morning, Father, we just thank you for the privilege and opportunity to worship you, to lift our voices to you. We love you. In the name of Jesus, amen.
The scriptures remind us that when we celebrate the Lord's table together, we're announcing, we're proclaiming the death and resurrection of Christ again, the essence of the gospel, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. And preparing our hearts for communion, and that we'll be sharing later this morning, I'm going to ask that you stand together as we sing The Power of the Cross. Let's read together this morning from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 7, which reminds us of our wonderful standing because of what Christ has done for us. Let's read together. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 3:1-7. Philip Bliss penned these wonderful words that he bore our shame. In my place, he was condemned. He sealed my pardon with his blood. Hallelujah. What a Savior. Hymn number 175. May be seated.
Good morning, church. What a blessing it is to be able to come and worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and be able to focus on his death and resurrection this morning. Well, Today is Communion Sunday, as you know, so the children will be staying with us. There's no children's church today. We're so glad to have them with us, to have our full body here together. And I want to invite you to open up your Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19. Now, before we jump into this today, I want to mention that this is the last day of our normal single Sunday school class. And then we're going to be doing one more next Sunday, and we're going to be doing the issue of social justice. I really feel strongly that this is an issue that has come up, of which many of us are confused or somewhat confused about a lot of the terms that we're hearing about. Where did this movement come from and where is it going? And so as a church, we need to be informed about what's happening in the world around us. And I'd like to try to do that in an hour next Sunday and just really try to unpack the basics of this movement, although it's incredibly complicated. But I do want to say this. It is showing itself as nothing less than a new religion. And so we really need to understand it. We need to understand where people are coming from. We need to understand the biblical response to justice and what that really looks like biblically. So I want to encourage you, if you'd like to come next week, it's just a one-and-done Sunday school lesson after church next week. Well, I talked about last week that we're gonna be encouraged today. And I really feel like this is a time where we all need encouragement. And I was looking at some of the jokes about the pandemic. You don't want to joke too much, but there was some pretty good ones that I saw, like this one. My mom always told me I wouldn't accomplish anything by living in bed all day. But look at me now, Mom. I'm saving the world. If I keep stress eating at this level, the buttons on my shirt will start socially distancing from each other. Since we're all in quarantine, I guess we'll be making only inside jokes from now on. That's what my kids call a dad joke. There's nothing like relaxing on the couch after a long day of being tense on the couch. And knock, knock, who's there? Seriously, don't touch my door and get back 6 meters to social distance. Those are just a few of the ones that are out there. And the truth is that after 6 months, almost 6 months now of all of the issues that we've been dealing with the pandemic, with the issues of our society and a lot of the tension that is happening with the social justice issues, we've had all kinds of natural disasters as well, especially more recently. And I was just hearing about in Iowa that they had a massive wind come through and just level a town. It's just been thing after thing after thing. And so this has, for all of us, caused some degree of a need for renewal because we've been depleted. We've gone through difficult times. I don't know that there's anybody that I've talked to who says, you know what, life's been great the last 6 months. It's just fabulous. It's just amazing. Nobody is saying this. And so as a church, as the body of Christ, we need to be renewed. And what better place can we be renewed than in the Lord? But I want to talk a little bit about some of the things that we're going through. And maybe some of these things you have personally really gone through. And you're going to say, amen, yep, that one's me. Yep, that one's me. Maybe it's just one of those things. Maybe it's nothing in there in particular, but there's been some other things that you've gone through that you need renewal from. But one of the things that we all have probably endured to some degree or another is stress. Stress. Stress is ubiquitous right now. I don't know anybody who would say, I'm not stressed, I'm stress-free. If you are, come talk to me. I'd love to hear your secret. But we're stressed about things like, at the beginning, first about getting food. We're stressed about getting work or continuing to work. We're stressed about school. That's one of the most recent ones, right? That going back to school has been incredibly stressful. And we can even get stressed about something like going to dinner. Well, the spot I want to go eat at, is it even open anymore? What are their new hours? What's going on? Will there be restrictions? And so there's a stress about this. And I still remember back in April, my family was undergoing a lot of stress because of what was happening. We actually left town before all of the changes hit our community. And so when we had just emptied out our pantry, we had no food left in the pantry. We were going to buy it all when we got back. We got back, realized that everybody was just taking everything. And so I had a hard time finding food, toilet paper, and to adapt to all these new restrictions. And so a number of weeks had gone by, And I decided one night, you know what, we need to relieve some stress, and one of the best ways I know to do that is to get some ice cream. So I decided I was going to go to Small Mart. You know, there's Big Mart, and there's Small Mart, the neighborhood Walmart. I decided to go over there one night and get some ice cream for my family, and I'm just excited to finally do something normal. And so walk into the aisle that has ice cream, and I look in the freezers, and the ice cream's gone. The ice cream is gone, and there's only like Ben and Jerry's and some of those ice creams that I'm too cheap to buy. And so I'm just looking at this going, are you kidding me? And I had my Popeye moment. You know, that's all I can stand, and I can't stand no more. And I just threw down my hands at that moment. I said out loud, I said, what? They took the ice cream too? And I'm sure the people in the aisle were looking at me going, he's lost it. This guy, he's lost it. You know, we've all probably had some experiences where the stress got the better of us during the last 6 months or so. And we've probably had experiences where we've had high stress moments where there was actually something that happened in our life that really increased the stress level. But there's also that low-level stress that's just always there, isn't it? It's just going outside is stressful. Staying at home is stressful because we can't go outside like we want to. But then when we go outside and we go do things, we're wondering, what are the restrictions going to be? What's the difference? How is this not going to be normal? How is it not going to be what I expected it to be? And so we're dealing constantly with this stress. And I'm going to guess this has made an impact on our walk with the Lord, that it has impacted our walk with the Lord. You know, another thing that's impacted us is depression. And I think this is a time where depression is at such a higher rate amongst us, and some of us are prone to more depression, and so we'll go into that, we'll turn into more depression. Some of us don't, but right now we're just like say a little bit depressed. We're just kind of down. We're just sort of feel downtrodden. We sort of feel beat down. We don't feel like we can move forward or progress. You know, when gloom and doom is constantly displayed on the news, and really no one is happy because no one is really getting what they want, when really people feel really out of control about the things of their life, depression is a natural cause. It's a natural result, actually, of what's going on. And so when these things continue on for months and months and months as they have, it's easy to sort of get to a fatalistic attitude and just say, I just give up. I'm just not going to try as hard anymore. And that may mean that we've decided we're just going to sit home and we're going to feel bad and we're going to veg out. It may mean that we pull away from relationships, and so we've isolated ourselves more from the people that we love. It may mean even more so that we are falling into a state of hopelessness. I feel like this is just never going to end and things are not going to get back to normal or the way they used to be. And so that depression is very possible for any of us, and it's detrimental to ourselves, right? And we know that it affects our relationship with God when we get to that point where we've lost hope and we have a difficult time seeing our way forward. Well, another thing that's affected is our aimlessness. Our aimlessness. You know, aimlessness is something that really affects people that are pattern people. Are you a pattern person? Do you need a pattern every day? I get up at this time, and I do this, and then I do this. Many of us are pattern people. I know I am. We thrive when we have a pattern, like get up, exercise, eat well, read your Bible, go through your messages, your emails, or your text messages, go to work, have lunch with a friend, go out to dinner with your spouse, go to growth group. You know, all of these things that are patterns in our lives have been discombobulated. They have been eliminated, or they have been changed to some degree. So now we have a difficult time focusing because now that we're out of our pattern, we're not doing our normal thing. So we do things randomly instead of intentionally, right? Now we do things, well, I might do that or I might not. I mean, I used to work out at the Y. I don't really know what to do these days because I just can't really go there. And so I do it randomly or I do it not at all. We may find ourselves just not knowing what to do on a daily basis. When you get to the weekend, you're, I don't know what to do, or even during your daily time. We binge watch a whole season of a show in one day. I mean, we do these things that we wouldn't normally do because we're out of our daily pattern, and this can lead to this sort of aimlessness where we don't know what's going to happen from one day to the next because we're out of our pattern. But not only can we get out of our daily pattern, but that can also lead to us getting out of our daily pattern with God. Perhaps We were on target with walking with God before all of this came down. Perhaps you were walking well with the Lord. Perhaps you had a regular pattern of Bible study and prayer. But has that been disrupted? Has that been changed since this has all happened? How has your walk with the Lord been? Has it been consistent, or has it been sort of random? Has it been sort of aimless? It's kind of like we can easily, when this whole thing started, have God on the phone and then be talking to God and say, God, I'm going to put you on hold. Pandemic's on the other line. I'll get back to you. I'll be right back. I'm sure I'll be right back. We've been saying that to God for 6 months. Lord, I'll get back to you. I'll get back to you on this. Pandemic's on the other line. Well, the fourth thing that a lot of us are dealing with right now is fear. And there are fears that we have now that we did not have 6 months ago. There are new fears. I mean, some of us struggle with fear regularly when there is no pandemic. But a lot of us have been dealing with fear now that there is one. And we're dealing with the small fears and the large fears. The small fears of how am I going to make this vacation work? How am I going to be able to go out to the store? How am I going to be able to do these things? But then we're also fearing a lot of the big issues, like, could I be dead in a few months from now? Is this the end of the line for me? What about someone that I love? What would happen if they caught this? And what would happen if they got into danger? Some of us have lost loved ones in the last 6 months for various reasons. And so there's this fear between life and death at this moment. And it's really challenging our faith, isn't it? Are we really able to trust the Lord with our life? Or have we given ourselves over to fear? And so there's just a lot of reasons why we need to be renewed in God. Amen? We need the Lord. We need the grace that He supplies. And I want to look at somebody who needed that just like we do today. And his name is Elijah. Elijah is a prophet of God. And in the story that we're going to look at today, in 1 Kings 19, Elijah was in the roughest spot of his life. He was living through the toughest time of his life. He was enduring all of the things that I just mentioned. Aimlessness, fear, depression, right? He was dealing with all of those things in his own life. And so we want to look at his life and how God renewed him, how God blessed him. So let me give you the background of chapter 19. This is the end of Elijah's career as a prophet. He's been following the Lord for a long time. He's a soldier for the Lord, and he's gone through a lot of rough times. But never has he gone through the rough time that he's about to endure. Some of us can relate to that all of our lives we've had to deal with difficulties, but there are sometimes later in life that difficult time that is extremely hard to overcome. He was a prophet in the idolatrous northern kingdom of Israel. This is during the time of the split kingdom. For those of us who are doing a walk through the Bible, this is where the kingdom is split, and you have the north is Israel, the south is Judah. And he had the job, the very difficult job, of preaching to a people whose heart was hard towards God, and they were following idolatry. Specifically, they were worshiping Baal. So Elijah sought to end Baal worship at the Lord's command. And so it came down to one big showdown on Mount Carmel, which very many of us are familiar with, where Elijah called for the 450 prophets of Baal to show up, and then he would be the singular prophet of God to show up. They would build an altar, and then they would call on each of their respective gods to call down fire from heaven and consume the sacrifice that they were offering. Of course, the prophets of Baal all day long were sitting there crying out to their God, trying to get their God to do something, and Elijah mocks them, if you remember that. He says, oh, maybe he's on a journey. You know, maybe he's forgotten about you. Maybe you need to yell a little louder. And so they did, and of course, nothing happened because Baal is a false god. But then Elijah prays to the Lord that he would show them his glory and display his power. And then fire comes down from heaven and consumes this wood and the whole sacrifice, even though they had poured water all over it. And then it's clear that God is real. And so then they have the 450 prophets killed them all to eliminate this Baal worship from the land. Not only that, but there was a multi-year famine that was across the land. And so at that moment, once God had showed up, then all of a sudden a cloud appears and rain starts to come. And so now the drought is over because the people have now supposedly ended partially their Baal worship. And so Elijah runs to the capital city the quarters of the king. His name is King Ahab. He runs to Jezreel, this capital area, and what he thought would be the moment of acceptance. He thought that now, finally, the nation has turned against Baal. And so now the king and his wife, they're going to be on my side. And so we get to chapter 19, and we find out he's up for a rude awakening, one of the most difficult times of his life after one of the greatest experiences of victory for the Lord that he's ever experienced. Let's take a look at verses 1 through 3. Ahab told Jezebel, that is his wife, the king's wife, all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, "So may the gods do to me and more also if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by this time tomorrow." Then he was afraid and he arose and ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. This is the point where we walk into Elijah's story and this low point of his life. Instead of receiving from the king and his wife commendation, he received condemnation. Instead of them saying, "Thank you for purifying our land," Jezebel, the idolatrous king's wife, calls for him to be killed. And when Jezebel says, "I'm going to kill you tomorrow," believe her, because she is very good at following her word. When she threatened to kill someone, she meant it. So it says that he ran for his life. And he ran and ran and ran, and he kept on running south. He went from all the way north in northern Israel. He ran to the southernmost city that he could possibly run to in Judah. Beyond that is only desert. And so he runs as far away from the situation as he can to get away from the situation. His expectations had come crashing down. His hope that finally the victory on Mount Carmel would lead to the people of Israel turning to the Lord. But there, it turned instead to opposition against God's prophet. And so he must have struggled with the idea that evil in his own nation could not be overcome. It's like he must have given up hope at this moment to say, "What can stop the reign of evil in my country?" Have you ever gotten to that point? What can stop the reign of evil and the increase of evil and idolatry in my country? What happens when I see the country that I love begin to disintegrate and pull apart at the seams? And so he runs away and he hides away, which we're all actually tempted to do sometimes. Let's just go run away to someplace that doesn't deal with these problems in the nation in which I live. And he tries to hide. And so he is just in the dumps. He has lost faith in the people of the land in which he lives. He may even be wondering, "Lord, where are you in all this? When are you going to check the evil? We had this great and wonderful victory, and yet Baal worship remains. So what is left for me to do? I'm a failure in what you've called me to do." And so it leads for Elijah the need to be renewed. And we want to look at how God renews him. And I want you to really notice here the gentleness with which God approaches this suffering servant, this depressed, fearful servant, in three renewals that God gives. The first renewal is renewal through God's spiritual sustenance. The renewal through spiritual sustenance from God. Let's take a look at verses 4 through 8. "But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree. And he asked that he might die, saying, 'It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I'm no better than my father's.' And he lay down and slept under a broom tree. And behold, an angel touched him and said to him, 'Arise and eat.' And he looked, and behold, there was at his head a cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. And he ate and drank and lay down again. And the angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, 'Arise and eat, for the journey is too great for you.' And he rose and ate and drank and went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the Mount of God," which, by the way, is Mount Sinai. Notice the grace by which God is treating this defeated servant. Just to get a picture of how down he really was, we see that Elijah has really swung from a conquering hero in the previous chapter to a dejected failure, or feeling like a dejected failure in the next. He has traveled as far away from trouble as he can get. And notice what happened back in verse 3. It says, when he got to Beersheba, he left his servant there. A lot of people think that that was an indication that he had not only run away from his own country, but now he'd run away from the ministry. He says, Lord, I'm done. I'm done being a prophet for you. I'm done working for you, Lord. This is just unachievable, this goal that you've given me. And so by leaving his servant there, people think he's done. And it's even indicated later because he actually then goes a day's journey outside of Beersheba, out into the wilderness. And what does he do? He says, Lord, just kill me now. My life is over. I don't want to live another day. I don't want to go on another day. I just want it to be over. He believes that the Lord takes life. He wasn't going to take his own life. But he's now given himself into God's hands to then end his life. And he requests it. He says, Lord, can you please just end it for me now? I just don't want to go on any further. Have you been there? Have you been at that spot where you said, Lord, I just can't see the light at the end of the tunnel. I feel so overwhelmed right now by this life. And maybe you felt like, you know, I've lived so long, Lord. I'm so tired of the fight. I'm so tired of evil and sin. I'd just rather be with you now. A lot of us get there. And so here he is. And notice that he lays down to die. And who shows up but an angel? A messenger from God. And what does he do? He makes him a cake. Now, I don't think it was a blackberry or an apple. I think it was just some bread. Bakes him a cake of bread. And he gets us some water. Now, if that just isn't a wonderful picture of God's grace, I don't know what is. This man has run for his life for miles and miles and miles. He is completely physically depleted and exhausted. Probably hasn't slept in days. And he's laying down to sleep. And the angel wakes him up. And he says, here, eat some food. Here, drink some refreshing water. Refresh yourself. Renew yourself with what I provide through the hand of God. It says, arise and eat. And so he looks, and verse 6, there's that cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. You can just imagine the grace that he would be receiving. It's just, it's there, it's cooking, it just smells wonderful, and the water must have been just such a delight, you know, and there's nothing like good, crisp, clean water. Just what a blessing of God. And so it says that he lay down to sleep again. He's so exhausted. He just that's all he can do. And God says, all right. Let him sleep. And then the angel touches him a second time and he says, arise and eat, for the journey is too great for you. It doesn't necessarily look like it's a command to go on a journey at this point, but he knows that Elijah's on a journey. Elijah's heading somewhere. He says, I know you're about to head somewhere, so you need to eat some more. You need to drink some more because you've got a major journey ahead of you, and I'm going to provide my grace for you. So it says he arises and he eats a second time in verse 8. And then it says, he went in the strength of that food that he just ate twice, for 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the Mount of God. Now, understanding the physiology of the human body, we understand that most bodies can't do that. You can't just go 40 days and 40 nights without eating and drinking. Although it just says he was without food, so we don't know about the drinking, but at least he went without food, right, for 40 days. But we realize when somebody is able to do that, that they do that by the strength that God provides. That this is somehow supernatural sustenance that he's given him, that God allows him to continue on and to be maintained so that he's not, you know, completely depleted once he gets to his destination. So it's not just this regular physical food that he's been given, but then God uses it to sustain him for 40 days of walking, hiking through all kinds of desert areas and desolate areas to the mountain of God, to Mount Sinai. And so the grace of God is just abundantly pouring out to Elijah at this moment. And the question for all of us, brothers and sisters, is, does God provide for us the same kind of spiritual nourishment, the kind of spiritual sustenance that will get us through this time as he did for Elijah? And I believe the scriptures say that he will. Would you turn with me to Isaiah 40? Isaiah 40. God promises to bring refreshing to all of his people when we seek his face. I'm going to read verses 29 through 31. Very familiar scriptures. But I want you to read this. Try to read this as if you're reading it for the first time and apply it to yourself. Isaiah 40, verse 29. He gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Some of you have at least that last verse up on your wall somewhere. You've got maybe a picture of it, because these are such encouraging words. And so at a time like this, we need these encouraging words. It tells us here that God gives power to us when we're faint. When we lack power, God gives it to us. It says he gives it. And then to him who has no might, he increases strength. So another way of saying it, he increases our strength when we don't have any. It says even people with natural strength, even people who can just go at life all day long, who can work 12-hour days of hard labor, even they get weary. Even they fall exhausted. But if you wait on the Lord, you will have strength that will carry you through not just 12 hours a day, but 24 hours a day. You will have strength that will get you through all day, every day. Notice what it says happens in verse 31. When you wait for the Lord, you shall renew your strength. Your strength shall be continually renewed on a continual basis from the Lord. You shall mount up with wings like eagles. How wonderful it would be able to be able to travel somewhere on the wings of eagles and just to get somewhere directly and just fly along just as fast as you can. What a wonderful picture that you shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. You can run all day long with the Lord and not be weary and just keep going. And you shall walk and not faint. I mean, I can't walk for 30 minutes or run for 30 minutes without getting tired. But spiritually speaking, and just trying to go through the marathon of life, God will continue to renew you and to keep you going by his strength. And what is the key to receiving it? Verse 31, but they who wait for the Lord. Those who wait for the Lord receive the strength to persevere that he provides. Now, that doesn't mean that you're just sitting around waiting on the Lord. Lord, I'm waiting for my strength. When's it going to show up? Kind of like waiting for an Amazon package. All right, it's supposed to be here. When's it coming? It doesn't mean waiting in terms of time. It means waiting in terms of trust. So what it means is if you wait on the Lord and trust him for your strength, instead of trying to find it in everything else that the world provides, then he'll give it to you. Then he'll give you everything you need. He'll give you so much power, so much energy to be able to continue on that you will be a faithful servant and you will be able to overcome whatever obstacle is coming your way by his power. That doesn't mean everything's going to work out in life, but it does mean that you can make it through it. It means that you can walk through it by his strength. And so our calling, brothers and sisters, is to wait on the Lord, trust him. And so that's really the question. When we get stressed, when we get depressed, when we go through difficult times, are we trusting in ourselves? Are we trusting in the world? Or are we trusting in God? And I think that's a great time for all of us to sit back and say, Lord, you know, maybe this during this time recently, I have not been trusting in you. I've been trusting in what people are telling me. I've been trusting in myself and my own self-preservation. I've been trusting in others to come through for me. But Lord, I'm not trusting you. Brothers and sisters, are our lives not in God's hands? Will we live a day longer or less that's different from the Lord's determination? The Lord has our lives in his hands. We will not live a day longer than what he has ordained. And so, how wonderful it is to be able to trust in the power of God to get us through. Now, let's take a look at renewal through God's word. So we're renewed by spiritual nourishment. We also are renewed by God's word. We turn back with me to 1 Kings 19. 1 Kings 19, we're going to read verses 9 through 12. Fascinating turn of events. He finally gets to this area of the Mount of God. There he came to a cave and lodged in it. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And he said, I've been very jealous for the Lord, for the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. And he said, go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. The sound of a low whisper. Let's stop there. Elijah had traveled over 200 miles from the area of Beersheba, even farther south to the Sinai Peninsula, to Mount Sinai. And so once he finally gets to the mountain, he finds this cave. And he goes inside the cave. And so God asks him a question. His word came to him. Now God is going to speak directly to Elijah. And the word that comes to Elijah is a question. He says, what are you doing here? That's a very important question. What are you doing here? It's like saying, how did you get here, Elijah? How did you get to the point where you're so depressed that you wanted to die? Where you are so discouraged that you want to give up on the ministry? What are you doing here? And what a powerful question that God could ask all of us. Brothers and sisters, what are you doing here on this earth? How did you get to this spot of discouragement? And he's saying this in a gracious way. He's saying, Elijah, is this really what I have for you? Is this really what your life has turned into? Because that's not what I wanted for you. It's almost like he's also saying, what are you running from? Elijah, what are you running from? Some of us have been running from God all of our lives. And God graciously comes to you and says, what are you running from? And so he asks this question. And here's the truth. Elijah doesn't have a good answer. Notice what Elijah says. He says, Lord, I have been in the past really jealous for you. The people have all bailed on you. They've forsaken your covenant. But I've tried to do everything that you called me to do. And I'm the only one left, Lord. I'm the only one who's faithful. Everybody else has turned away from you. They're all unfaithful to you. I alone am faithful. And I'm just tired of it. That's not a very good answer. That's an answer of discouragement. That's an answer of lack of hope in God. And that's a statement of lack of trust of God maintaining a remnant of people for himself. In other words, he basically can't see anything but himself. All he thinks about is himself and saying, Lord, I'm just so discouraged because I am the only one faithful to you and no one else is, and no one else is following you like I do, and I'm just so sick of it. And people often do this when they become aimless and depressed and without hope. That's the kind of answer that this is. Elijah presented the worst part of the scenario. Notice what he leaves out. God, you showed up on Mount Carmel. And you conquered the servants of Baal. Lord, you are working history to your end. Lord, you defeat evil. Lord, I am on the side of victory. Lord, you have used me in great and mighty ways. Elijah doesn't say any of that. That's not what he's thinking about. He's only thinking about the stuff that isn't working. And then he makes it an exaggeration and says, nothing's working, and I'm the only one who's faithful to you. It's all lost. Do we do that sometimes? Do we see failure when there is no failure? Do we actually act like God has failed when he hasn't failed? Do we act like evil will win when it will be defeated? Do we feel lost when we have been found? Do we feel like we only have death when you've been given eternal life? Do we paint things in the bleakest of pictures without looking at all the good things that God has done and be thankful? Sure we do. I do it. Sure we do. We get to that point. And so I just want you to see here that God is not going to rail against Elijah for this. God is going to show up in a gracious way. He's going to respond with grace to Elijah's difficulty. Notice the big powerful things that show up. He shows up in a powerful wind, but it says, in this powerful wind, he wasn't there. There's a great earthquake, and no, God's not in that. There's great fire. Nope, God's not gonna come and bring a bunch of fire. By the way, these were all displays that Moses had seen and feared God on the mountain. But God shows Elijah these things, but it says that God was not in those things. And then what does he do? He hears this whisper. And that's what God is in. God is in the still, small voice. When we even rail against God, how does he answer us? With the grace of a still, small voice. Isn't God gracious? And Elijah needed this grace because he was so broken. Notice what verse 13 says. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and he went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. He wanted to hear from God, and God's whispering to him. And he says, Lord, and he gets a little bit of desire to hear what God has to say, but he covers his face. He's still full of shame. He's still broken. He's hiding his face from God by covering it with his cloak. Isn't that interesting? How many times have we covered our face before God? And we just don't feel like we can handle his truth. We just don't feel like we can handle what he's got for us. He's still hiding from God. And so then he comes out, and what does he receive? A whisper, another question. He receives another question. And behold, there came a voice to him, and he said, what are you doing here, Elijah? He asked him again, because Elijah hadn't got the message. Elijah only saw the negative. He wasn't seeing what God was doing. And so he asked him in a whisper, Elijah, what are you doing here? Brothers and sisters, how good it is that God chooses to whisper his word to us rather than shout it into our ears, rather than hit us over the head with a hammer. I have found that only the people that God hits with a hammer are those who are completely walking away from him. And we need it when that's the case. But when we are walking with the Lord, when you are a believer in Jesus Christ, God whispers to you. My wife and I went on a cruise a number of years ago, and we were so excited. It's the only cruise I've ever been on. We'd never been on a ship before, and it was for me a major source of anxiety because I don't like confined spaces, and so I'm staying on a ship in a cabin. And so we went out to go walk around and experience the outside, and here we are. We're in Long Beach, California, and it was a beautiful evening, and we're seeing these animals and dolphins swimming around in the ocean. It was just really cool. So we get to the top of this cruise ship before it's about to set sail, and we start walking around to the front of the ship, to the bow, the very top, on this really awesome railing, and we had known that in just about a few minutes that the ship was about to set sail and about to head out to sea. So we wanted to see the departure. So we got out there, and people are just doing all these things, you know, just enjoying, laughing, having a good time. We're all standing on the rail with all these people, and all of a sudden, we hear one of the loudest sounds I've ever heard. Honk! Little did we know, we were standing right in front of the foghorn, which announces the departure. And so we absolutely freaked out. People were falling on the ground, and they didn't know what was going on. And then afterwards, we all just kind of laughed, like, well, what a bunch of idiots we are, you know, standing in front of this thing. Aren't you glad God doesn't communicate like that? Aren't you glad God doesn't communicate in a way that just blows you away and where you just can't handle it? I mean, we know from the Old Testament when God did do that at certain times, people said, woe is me. I can't handle when God speaks loudly. I can't handle when God is showing his power because it's too great for me. Woe is me. I am undone. But God most often is not going to yell. He's going to whisper his words of encouragement in a kind and gentle way that you can take to heart, that you can receive. You know, let me ask you a question. Have you felt like throughout this time of pandemic, like maybe God's not talking to you? Like maybe you're distant from God? Maybe that's because he's using the gentle approach. Maybe that's because he's just softly whispering, but we're just having a hard time hearing it. So sometimes when we feel like we're distant from God, it may be that God is actually reaching out to us because he's not hitting us over the head. He's not using some big experience to give us a wake-up call. He's using his gentleness to get you to come back, to get you to listen and walk out of the cave a little bit and say, okay, what was that? What was that, Lord? What were you trying to communicate to me? And God knows us as people, and He knows that we will respond to His still small voice, that we'll respond to His gentleness. Most likely He's ministering to you by the Word of God that you already have planted in your heart. If you will listen to God, that the Word of God that you have planted in your heart, He will speak to you. He will say to you, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. He'll say, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He says, I desire that they also whom you have given me may be with me where I am to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. He says to you, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Have you heard the Lord speaking those truths to you? Have you heard Him speaking the word that He's implanted in your heart? And you just remember it on a certain occasion. The Holy Spirit is bringing it to mind. Listen to the Lord speaking His word to you. That's how He renews your soul. Lastly, God gives us a renewal through God's perspective. God wants to give us a perspective that renews our hearts and renews our minds. Notice what He says in verse 14. After He says, what are you doing here, Elijah? He said, I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I am left, and they seek my life to take it away. Have you heard that before? He actually repeats the exact same thing, the exact same answer to the first question, which tells us that Elijah didn't get it. Now God's whispering to him, and Elijah doesn't realize that God is going to win, that God is all-powerful, that God will overcome evil. He's still caught up in his own depression. He's still caught up in his own negativity. And so God knows what to do. Verse 15, the Lord said to him, go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi you shall anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel-Mehola you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to death, and the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to death. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him. That's giving Elijah perspective. Elijah wasn't getting it. He wasn't getting the still small voice. He wasn't totally revived from the spiritual nourishment that God provides. So He gives him a new perspective. He needed to know that God will overcome evil in the end, and He's only a small part of this plan. That's a big perspective. That the evil around us is great, but God is greater. And I'm just a small piece in the big cog of God's machine for overcoming evil in this world. And so it's not all dependent upon me. The world is not dependent all upon me doing what God has called me to do. It's dependent on the whole kingdom of God doing what God has called them to do. And even then, God is still greater than His church. God is still more powerful, and He is the one who truly moves history in the direction that He wants it to go. God, brothers and sisters, God knew what was going to be happening for the last 6 months in our country. And God is in control. Amen? We may feel like we aren't in control. We may be wondering what to do, but God isn't. And God knows exactly what He's doing. And I believe that God will succeed in His efforts. The question is only, will you play your role? Will you play your part? But whether or not we do, God will still succeed. So God sent him to ordain. That God sent Elijah to ordain a new king of Syria, a new king of Israel to replace Ahab, and a new prophet to even replace him. He says, Elijah, your role is done. Rest. Because I'm going to use somebody else now to do it. So you can rest and just watch. Watch me work and watch me eliminate Baal worship from Israel. God would use this group to achieve His objectives through military might, through government powers, and through being a prophet, and they were going to eliminate what Elijah had been so beaten down by. Not only that, but God had preserved 7,000 God worshipers in the nation who were faithful. Elijah's saying, look, I'm the only one who's faithful, Lord. I'm the only one who's really following you. And God says, no. It's not all about you, Elijah. I've got 7,000 faithful people ready to stand against Baal in a moment's notice. You see, in the face of evil, it's really easy to lose perspective, isn't it? It's easy to think that evil will win. It's easy to think that you are the only faithful believer in God. And boy, have I heard it lately. people on different sides of the aisle on this pandemic saying, we're the only faithful ones because we do this. We're the only faithful ones because we do this. The church has become apostate. The church has rejected their calling. We're the only ones who are doing it right. Or I'm the only one who's doing it right. And it's easy to lose hope and plan for the worst, isn't it? It's easy to say, look, all is lost. Our country is done. I'm going to go get a cabin in the mountains, and I'm going to build my bunker, right? And I'm going to live on top ramen. That's giving up on God. God is faithful, and He says that in the end, He wins. And if you follow Him, then you will reign with Him forever and ever and ever. Isn't that wonderful? And all we need is a little perspective sometimes to be able to get back to that point where we see that the goodness of God triumphs over evil no matter how we feel. You are one of many faithful Christians throughout the world. You are one of many faithful churches throughout the world. God has not left you alone in your struggle. He has faithful people all throughout the world fighting the good fight. And it is God who guides us and brings beauty from ashes. God is the God who takes what men plan for evil and turn it to good. God is the God who allows evil to start celebrating and then shows up and gains the victory. And so we can say with the psalmist in Psalm 119, Lord, give me understanding that I may live. Help me understand that though the things I see around me are gloom and doom, Lord, that you are the victorious Lord of the universe and that I am on your side. And so I will ride the train of victory all the way to the end. And so a different perspective can get us out of aimlessness, hopelessness. It gives us a direction and purpose for our lives where we get up every day and we don't say, Lord, how long till the end? We say, Lord, what have you got for me today? Let's not squander our pandemic. Let's ask God, what good are you doing through this time? Lord, let's not get ourselves on the sidelines. Let's get into full play mode. Let's say, Lord, renew my strength so I can keep going. Lord, help me in a face of the fear of people of death to give them the truth of life. Help me, Lord, to encourage people around me to be able to walk faithfully with you as I am finding my encouragement in God alone. When we ourselves have been encouraged and renewed by God, then we have the ability to minister to others and to be able to use this time for His glory. But we have to believe that God, and have that perspective, that God is actually using this time for His glory. He's actually working. He's actually doing things that are great and wonderful and powerful. So it's time to take God off hold and enter back in. It's time to enter back into our relationship with the Lord, full dependence, and walk with Him each and every day. Well, this is the time of the Lord's Supper. And I want to share with you something from our doctrinal statement. Our doctrinal statement says why we practice the Lord's Supper. And it says this: the Lord's Supper is a commemoration of His undying love and symbolizes the fact that the believer is continuously fed and nourished by Christ. That's our doctrinal statement. Isn't that neat? It says two things. It says one is it's an understanding that God's love for you is undying. God's love for you never ends. And the way we know that is through the cross. Because Jesus died for you. And that death is going to affect you for the rest of eternity as it brings you into His family and adopts you as the child of God and a member of His kingdom, a citizen. And so because those things are secure, we know that His love for us is undying, and we celebrate it by remembering the cross. Because we know that Jesus died for you. He died for me. He died for our sins. And by dying, He shows that He loves us. You know, brothers and sisters, sometimes we just forget that. We think about all the things we do wrong, and we think, man, God must be so frustrated with me. But remember, the Lord's Supper is a commemoration of His undying love for you. Just let that soak in. Just let that marinate this morning. God loves you. And when you take that bread and you eat it and you drink of that juice, then you're thinking about, this is for me. This is how much Jesus loves me. And his love is unconditional. And I can accept that this morning. And the second thing it says is that it symbolizes the fact that the believer is continuously fed and nourished by Christ. Isn't that awesome? Elijah was fed and nourished by the Lord in his depression. And where do we get our nourishment from? The bread and the wine. We get our nourishment from the cross, from the price he paid. That from the cross, the grace of God is continuously coming into our lives, empowering us, guiding us, and it continually keeps us in his goodness and away from his wrath. And so we're continually nourished by Christ. And this is a wonderful picture. That's how we are renewed in eagle's wings. It's through the cross, right? We fly because of the cross, because Jesus paid the ultimate price for us. So as we're about to take the elements this morning, as we're thinking about it, I want to encourage you to really be renewed by the cross. Be really renewed in what Jesus has done, with the undying love that he has for you and the nourishment that he provides. He has given us everything we need for life and godliness through the cross. And so I want to encourage you to think about that, to reflect on that. I want to take just a few minutes and just sit silently and pray and turn to the Lord. Maybe you have some business to deal with the Lord. Maybe you have pressed pause on your relationship with the Lord. And maybe it's time to press unpause. And if so, it's a good time to pray about that and to turn to him and seek his face alone for encouragement during this time. Let's pray to our Savior today to renew our spirits and lift us up on eagle's wings through the power of the cross to overcome our sin and death and give us life everlasting. Let's pray. Symbol of remembrance. This is for anyone who's a believer in Jesus Christ. So even if you're here for the first time today, if you're a believer in Jesus Christ, you're part of the family of God. And so you are very welcome to join us in communion. And you take that little top vellum part off. And you get that little wafer out. And then you pull back the red tab to get at the juice. And I'll go ahead and prompt you as we go. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's take eat. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant, which is in my blood. Do this after as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's take drink. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you have provided for us the perfect sacrifice. We thank you for the renewal that you give us in our hearts and our spirits. And Lord, I pray that as you renew us, Lord, that we would enjoy walking with you in a time when other people are full of stress and anxiety and aimlessness. Lord, that we would be different. but that it would be a supernatural renewal that you would give us. And so, Lord, we pray for that this morning. Revive us again. We pray this in the name of Jesus. And all God's people said, amen.
Would you stand with us, please? We celebrate with a song called Days of Elijah.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sword, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. And these are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. These are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation come. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun at the trumpet call. So lift your voice, year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation come.
Amen. It's a celebration. All right, this next one's got some clapping. So hands out of the pockets. I will celebrate. Boom, boom. Sing unto the Lord. Boom, boom. I will sing to him a new song. No clap. I will celebrate. Boom. There we go. We got it. All right. Here we go.
I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song. I will praise him, for he has triumphed victoriously. I will praise him, for he has triumphed victoriously. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I will praise him, for he has triumphed victoriously. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me, for me, for me. Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me. My God shall supply all my needs according to his riches and glory. He who gives his angels charge over me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me, for me, for me. Jehovah Jireh cares for me. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song. I will celebrate. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song.
Amen. Woo! Thank you so much for coming and worshiping with us this morning. Please stick around. We've got Sunday school for all the ages. Just chances to spend some time here. Sunday school doesn't start until 11:15, so you can spend time to say hello to everyone, greet new faces. So please stick around. We're going to dismiss the back few rows first, so we'll sing through that. I will celebrate one more time real quick as they get dismissed, and then you're all dismissed.
I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song. I will praise him, for he has triumphed victoriously. I will praise him, for he has triumphed victoriously. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song. I will celebrate, sing unto the Lord. I will sing to him a new song.